So a couple of announcements before I introduce our guest speakers. I just want to check in with you guys with your final papers. If you look over the instructions, if you have any questions, if you have one question, via email. I just want to make sure.
If we're done, can we submit to the speaker?
Yeah, I probably prefer that to be a hard copy. If you want me to look at a rough draft. Now I would like you guys know that my example final paper is up there. And just to let you know, I sent it to my husband and my mom. It brought them to tears. Both of them. So not only is it a good thing that you guys get to, you know, plan these things and let them know, but you should also know that if you do give it to your parents, to let them know what your final wishes are. And they may get a little upset. It might also be a good time to ask them for a little cash. So win-win on that front. Okay. If you have any more questions about the final paper, please let me know. On Blackboard, I posted a discussion. Dr. Geary, our speaker for next week, is going to be talking about death in the military. Wanted to know your questions that you have about death in the military. So your questions there would count towards your participation rate. I just ask that you put up one question that you have for her. Was your hand up? Or? So please do that by Wednesday of next week. There's an announcement on Blackboard. I can do it so it sends you a copy. I might forget after everything that happens today. So you just remind me if I do forget. There was a thank you card that was getting passed around for Mr. Sadler from last week. Is it still getting passed around? Did everyone sign it that wanted to?
No.
And then today, I just want you to make sure that you use very loud voices when you're asking the speakers questions, if you don't mind. And you guys have any questions for me before I introduce our guest speakers? Who I've already kind of introduced to you because they were in the video we watched last week. So we have Mike Hampton and Diane Jones. They're from the Parents of Murdered Children. And today they're going to be sharing their stories with you. So please welcome Diane and Mike.
How to bring you into understanding the subject we go through the studies. And I'm going to need your participation, so kind of participate with you. I'm going to ask you to kind of close your eyes as I previously, and kind of go with me with what I'm saying. The poem is called, Have You Ever? Have you ever been in love? I mean, really in love. The kind of love that when it's ended, you are totally broken. To the point you just feel sick. You can't eat. You can't sleep. You just feel plain old hopeless. Now I want you to reach deep down inside your thoughts and find all the loves you've ever known in your life. The love of your family, friends, the love of your pets, and even prized possessions. Now embrace that memory for a few seconds. Taking all your loves, big and small, and letting them fill your thoughts. Do you remember the joys of these loves? Are these memories bringing back smiles and a warm feeling in your heart? What a special and wonderful feeling out there. Yet these feelings you are embracing can barely begin to scratch the surface of a love one feels for their child. Now I want you to think about a hurt. Have you ever experienced a hurt? I mean, really experienced the hurt. A hurt where you didn't think you could go on. You were so disappointed that it had to turn out that way. Deep, deep, sorrowful hurt. Please reach deep down inside of you and find all that pain that came with that hurt. Now think about it. The pain of failure, the pain of regret, the pain of loss, the pain of illness, and the pain of rejections. Let all these pains resurface in your heart and fill it with that unforgettable sorrow. What an awful, terrible ache. Yet that ache barely begins to scratch the surface of the devastating sorrow and pain one feels at the loss of a child. Have you ever had to keep yourself awake at night because every time you closed your eyes to try and go to sleep, the funeral of your child and them being placed in a grave are your only dreams? Have you ever sat up and tried to daydream about happy memories of your loved one to only have them interrupted by the fact that you will never, ever again be able to hear their voice, to see them, to touch them, or to hug them. And yes, as a parent, even fuss at them. Never, ever again. Have you ever? For all of you that haven't, we the families of murder victims pray that you never.
I'm Myla Hanson, as your instruction gave you, and I have lost my son, Tommy. On February the 17th, he came to my house, and we talked about what was going on, and this is in 1994, talked about what was going on at his work at the hotel in Raleigh, the Sheraton Imperial, and he was so excited about new things. He was a beverage manager there, and he was excited to tell me about it, and he wanted to know if his sister could spend the night at the house to look after his dog while, because he was going to be late that next Friday night. So I said, yeah, Charlotte would be happy to stay here. So he left Next morning, I kissed him goodbye, as usual. He's 36 years old. I still kiss him, you know, at that time. So that's just that love that you have for a child. And so on the next morning, Friday, I left with four other people going to a meeting in Eastern North Carolina, Oriental. I don't know whether any of you know where Oriental, down on the coast of that. And it was a church meeting. So we had a wonderful trip down. Saturday morning, got up and went to walk with a couple of friends. Came back, and they wanted, all of a sudden, I had one of my friends and one of the ministers to come and say they want to, let's go over and talk together. So I thought, well, we were going to interview because our minister had left and gone to another church, and we were interviewing and talking about, you know, what to expect from somebody. So when I got to the room, I didn't see anyone else there. And I was very surprised. And that's when one of our members told me that he had just gotten a call from my daughter, saying that, actually my daughter and the former minister, telling them that my son, Tommy, had been murdered. Well, that was a climax and a feeling that I will never, never, ever forget. It just did something to me. I couldn't believe it. In fact, I said, I thought we were here for something else. And so, you know, there was a lot of discussion and talk there. So hurriedly, we packed everything and started home. Fortunately, I was not driving, because I'm sure if I had been, I would have tried to fly. But you lose all consciousness of what's going on. It's a different atmosphere around you. It's a different feeling. And I, unfortunately, had to ask that we stop along the way four times before we got to Durham, because I was just in such a situation. But it was one of those things that happens. It's part of the feeling and the part that happens to you when this does. Of course, there was a funeral. And when I got home, there was so many cars and people there. And of course, we had the funeral. And I had my son cremated, because my husband had previously died 6 months before this happened. So he had always wanted to be cremated, so I had told him, yes, that Tommy could be cremated. Then we had the police came, you know, they wanted to know what I could tell them about Tommy, which was very little, and what they could tell me, that he had been stopped by some young men, and he had been shot. And so, you know, I couldn't understand that. And it happened in an area that I had taught children. At that time, I was teaching kindergarten. And I had taught children in that area. Well, not at that time, I'm sorry. I taught kindergarten. And this was years later, which I knew that these young children had finished high school and everything. And I thought, oh, what if one of them? But fortunately, it wasn't. I did not know the people at all, never heard of them. So from time, days went on, and we had discussions about what was going on there. The police had to locate the arrest them, and they were all four arrested, and they were in jail. As time moved on, they did say that one of the young men had shot Tommy. It was one of the others that turned state evidence. And it's such a sad thing to think of young men doing this. I just, you know, I couldn't help but worry about all of them. And I had a minister that asked the that I go to Compassionate Friends. Compassionate Friends, I don't know whether you know or not, is a group that works with families that lose a child from illness, a suicide, wrecks, and various things like that, but not murder. And so I felt like that was not the place for me. So I talked to the minister again, and so we found out that there was a new group in Durham that had just started, our Parents of Murdered Children. And it was Nellie Jones, who was the wife of a undertaker, and she helped him there in the funeral home. And they had had many families to come to them. And so she had started this group in 1993. So I went to that, and I found that that was the place that I needed to go, because there you can express your feelings, talk, and you can, they can have a feeling for you that you don't have. As time went on, the trial took place. And of course, there are all kinds of bond hearings that take place, and then the trial. And at the trial, it came out that they had thought that Tommy was an undercover policeman, which I still can't imagine that because he wore a tuxedo shirt and so at his work and all. And so how could they think that he was an undercover policeman? I've never understood that. But anyway, he was tried and went through several days of being in court, which is not the most pleasant thing in the world. You hear things over and over again that have happened and all. And so finally the trial ended and he was given life, because it was before the new rules were made that they did not have to give life, but they could be in prison, you know, for a long time. So I was glad for that, because I never wanted life, him to be put to death. That's something I do not believe in and never will, to put somebody else to death. I didn't like that at all. But it was a trial that went on, like I said. And one of the things that you may never have heard about is the jurors insisted that they go to the scene where he had been killed, and they did, and they came back with that verdict, as I said. And the trial then proceeded, was ended, and later on the appellate court came back and said that the judge did not do his part, and they were right about that, because they did not accept one of the witnesses' written statement, that she would not testify in court. I've never seen anything like that. Of course, I'd never been to court anyway. So that was a very different part of my life, to see somebody else that couldn't, you know, answer the questions and talk to them like they should. So as time has passed, I have become very involved with Parents of Murdered Children, and hopefully today you all will learn something from our experience. And Diane will be next, and I want to read this.
Not yet.
Okay. Sorry about that. Spoke too quickly.
I'm kind of emotional, so forgive me if I get emotional. And I had to write this down because I want you all to hear everything. My name is Diane, as you all know, and I am serving a life sentence. This sentence was imposed on me March 25th, 1997. 15 minutes before noon. My sentence began with a phone call, my daughter's voice on the other end, saying, "Mama, don't get upset, but Butch has just been shot." It's amazing to me that I can still remember every word and every detail of that day, even to the clothes that I was wearing. I was wearing a green sweater and black stretch pants. 19 years, 8 months, and 10 days. How much of my life sentence that I've already served. I remember running, screaming from way deep down inside of me, saying, "God help me." I was at work and it seemed like people started to come out from everywhere. And then I just collapsed to the floor. After that, everything and everybody seemed to be moving in slow motion, with exception to my heart. It was beating so hard and fast, I couldn't seem to breathe right. I felt sick, as if I needed to lay down, but I couldn't. I had to get to my son. I arrived at the hospital. They take me in this room. All my family starts to arrive. No one is telling me anything. Finally, the doctor comes in and tells us that my son had been shot. In the head. I'm sorry. This is still hard for me. 19 years later, it's still hard. He had been shot in the head, and they had done all they could do, and that I could go say my goodbyes. I was not prepared for what happened next. I walked into this room. There was this person lying on a bed, blood all over the sheets, blood all over the bandages that was wrapped around his head. There were so many machines. His head was the size of a pumpkin. Where is my son? And what have you all done to me? I go to him and I grab his hand, telling him that I am there and that I love him so, so much. And if you can hear me, please just squeeze my hand. And he did. I screamed to the doctors that he's not dead. My son is not dead. They moved him to the ICU room. My son struggled for his life for 18 long hours. As I sat there holding his hand and wiping tears of blood that streamed down the sides of his face. I have never felt so hopeless in my life. My son was dying right there before my eyes. And there was nothing I could do to save my child. Needless to say, my son didn't make it, but he did give a gift of life to 5 other people that were in need of organ transplant. I tell my story today not for your sympathy. Mine is just one of many victims' families who are having to endure this unbearable pain. For the rest of our lives, we will be remembering the day that senseless violence took the lives of our loved ones. For the rest of our lives, we will be putting flowers on a grave. For the rest of our lives, we will be trying to get through the sweetest night. Because for some reason, after a loved one is killed, you don't sleep anymore. People are always talking about closure. There is never closure. This word closure means to stop or put an end to. But you tell me, how do I stop loving my child? How do I stop missing my child? You may be asking, why is she telling us this awful story? I'm here because this story is real to me, and I want you to understand the lifelong effect that violence leaves behind. I'm here because I don't want my story to be your story or your family's story. I'm here because I don't want my son's story to be another young man's story. But the most important reason that I'm here is because I am a parent. And this is what parents do. We fight for the lives of our children and for other people's children. We love you, and we need you all to survive. Thank you.
Survivors of homicide victims, each year, approximately 15,000 men, women, and children are victims of criminal homicide in the United States. As staggering as that figure is, it does not begin to indicate the toll of suffering that homicide extracts. If one estimates that each of its victims is survived by a minimum of three loved ones for whom the violent death will produce deep and bitter grief, the annual casualty rate escalates to over 45,000 individuals. And if one appreciates the intensity and duration of the trauma that's suffered by these survivors, we can conservatively estimate that we have in our midst approximately 500,000 wounded and scarred Americans, all victims of the murder of just the past decade. And on your desk, you will find some papers that we hope that will give you some information of how murder affects each and every one in a different way. We're all not affected in the same way.
Murder, just the word, conjures up very strong emotions. What a devastating blow murder is to the survivors left behind. There's a huge mountain of emotional baggage to drag around during your grief. All the conflict and emotions are presented different to different people. Homicide, grief can contain guilt, regret, blame, anger, and a lot of rage, but not the white hot rage. I didn't understand when I read that, what's the white hot rage. For me, my anger, I guess it wasn't white, it was red. And I still have anger because my son's case was never solved. And I didn't show you all my wonderful son. This is my handsome, handsome son, David, we call him Butch. And I want to share a happy, pretty much good day. You see, I'm very tall. And he would get a kick out of me, even in middle school. I would go to the school or something, and young guys would say, there's a girl looking for you when I come down. That's my mom. So he would get a kick out of people thinking I was his goal. That's my friend's thought. But I'm not going to read all this to you. I know that you all have gone through a lot of different things in your class, and I would like to open it up for questions. So if you all have questions, because that's what we're going to do, to answer your questions.
After the death of my child, when people start,
I don't even remember half of the family. When you get the news, your body and mind goes into a shock. Did you say shock?
Yeah.
A numbness. You become numb. People are around you and they're talking, but you're looking at them and it seems like they're talking like, you don't hear words. You are so consumed with your hurt and your grief that you, I remember saying, why are they talking to me? Don't they understand my son is dead? I just want to bury my child. I just want, and then you're saying, I want to bury him, and then you don't want to bury him because you start thinking about all the crazy things about he's going to go into a casket in a grave, and he's going to be cold, and your mind is around all this has just happened to you. What about you?
Well, even though I had Tommy cremated, I still had a lot of feelings about that, if I did the right thing. I never saw Tommy after that day that he came by the house. And so that has sort of bothered me for a while. But with people coming, yes, that is overwhelming. And you really, it's so difficult to explain the feeling that you have. It's different from anything else that ever has. Even when my husband died, I told you that. That was different. He had been sick. So, that was a different thing. And then my mother died the year after Tommy was killed. And so that was even different too. So it's different because you know that death is coming when somebody has been sick for a long time. Even though it hurts when it happens, it hurts an awful lot, but it's still different to think that somebody has taken the life of the child that I loved and cared for and had. So,
have a daughter, and she has three daughters. After my son died, my daughter moved out at the age of 19 because she said she couldn't take it. I was frantic. I still am. I'm scared about everything and everybody in my family. I'm scared something is going to happen to somebody else in my family. Now, my daughter has three daughters, and she is so overprotective, and I'm telling her now, you got to let up, because her oldest is 19, and I'm not going to let her go anywhere. It puts a permanent fear in you. It did for me. And I think mine, too, is that the person was never caught for kidnapping. So I think that compounds my fear.
When your son died, would you guys use a cohort to use as a support system?
I got drunk. I'm just going to be honest with you. For a year, every day, I would come home, I would cook dinner, and I would go in my kitchen, and I would shut the door, and I was drinking beer at that time, and I would drink about 4 beers, and I smoked a half a pack of cigarettes every night for a year. And what stopped me was my daughter. I had a grandbaby, Mia. Mia was 1.5, almost 2, and she came to the door one night, and she was knocking on the door. She said, "Me, Mom. Why are you in there going?" And I started laughing. And I said to myself, oh my God, I've been doing this for so long. that kind of snapped me out of my drinking and smoking. And I haven't smoked since then. I'm still drinking, but I haven't smoked since then.
By the time piggyback traveled, what he was saying. So did you find that support groups or like psychological support or like therapy, which one did you find more beneficial?
To cope, yes.
That was when I went to Parents of Our Children.
Okay.
Yeah. Because I needed that. Nellie Jones, who was in charge, was really fantastic. And I, you know, that was what really helped me. And to answer his question, I ran. I worked. I did something every single day. And I overdid it. But I felt like that I was, you know, being compensated for doing something. But, and I know that I did things that I should not have done. But, I don't smoke.
I went to a psychologist or whatever you call it, about 6 months after my son's death, because I had this hole in my chest. And I had lost down to about 80 pounds. And during that time, I never weighed over 92. And, I couldn't eat. I couldn't sleep. And this hole was in my chest. And I kept telling people, I got a hole in my chest. And I still have now a hole. But instead of it being this big, it's about this big. And like I said, they wanted to give me medication. I tried for medication and I was like a zombie. But after going to Parents of Murdered Children, I went to Parents of Murdered Children a year later in January of 1998. My son was killed March of 97. And when I got there, I was still in such grief that I couldn't talk when I walked in the room. Mina and Nellie and a lady from the DA's office was there. And the reason I went to Parents of Murdered Children, they had started sending papers out when they found out my son was killed, that come to me, have a group that we can help you come to this meeting. I would just push them aside. But this particular time, they said, if you got a case and you haven't had any questions answered, please come to this meeting. And I went to that meeting and I couldn't talk. I couldn't even tell them what my name was.
She was in bad shape. She really was. But we love her and still do. And see what she can do today. No. She is so honest and so sincere about what happened. And we're blessed to have her with us, even though it's a sad way to have somebody join us.
When I went there, they told me to start writing. Since I couldn't talk out like stuff, because I was just white stuff. And the first thing I wrote was this poem here. I had heard, we started going through things when Amber asked us to come to this class, and this lady has her book from when her son was first killed, and I want you all to take a look at how detailed. She has to keep notes, and you just have to stay on top of everything, because if you don't, your case will be blown to the side. And in her book, she had the first thing that I wrote, because I couldn't tell them. I remember everybody said, what's wrong with you? And I wrote this poem. When I got to the meeting that next month, and they were talking, and they said, Diane, do you have something? And I remember handing them this poem, and they put it in their newsletter. And the poem is called, What's Wrong? I cry and people say, what's wrong? I feel sad and people say, what's wrong? What's wrong? My son is gone. I will never see him on this earth again. Someone took his wife. I still cry at night. I feel so alone. No one understands that he will always be my son. He is not just a picture. He is not just a thought. He is my child, the one that I first saw walk. He is the boy that never really became a man. He is still my son, my very first best friend. And I wrote this in 1998. And from then on, they kept telling me that I had a gift, so I started talking. A year later, I had to shut up. I don't know what my heart was, but I know my rage was, it was red. When I closed my eyes at night and cried, all I saw was red. So when I read that thing about white hot rage, when I was reading, I don't think I experienced white hot rage. My rage was red at the anger of someone taking my son's life. And I think mine was also red because my son's case was handled very badly. The detective would not talk to me. And I'm still angry. And that's one reason that I still fighting here almost 20 years later. You're going to hear me. And I'm not going away because my child is under. So I think that's my red hot rage.
And I don't know that I was angry and I was hurt to think that somebody would do that. And then we were having more murders that year than we had had in a good while. And so back then,
go ahead, Mom. Maybe you were talking about the murders that year?
Yeah.
This the murders in Durham that time were in the large numbers, Durham's small city. We have never had a lot of murders. That was one of the reasons that Mary Jones, the funeral home director, started this chapter, was because a lot of young people were being killed during that time. And, you don't mind if I say, 90% of them were black. And this book, we started this booklet after I got into the group. I started looking and wanted to understand how, and so many of my son's friends were killed. The year my son was killed, 97, I think it was like 40-something numbers. And the numbers kept going up and up over the years. So now we have this booklet, and we went back to 1993 when the chapter was started and tried to find everybody. And that booklet right now contains about 780-something numbers.
I was going to ask you, did you feel like because your son was an African-American male, they didn't take you as serious? Like, the detectives and the judicial system didn't take you as serious?
For me, my son was killed in a drug area of town. During those years, the gang stuff had started growing and on, and it was like, let them kill each other off. I mean, people were calling about the gunshots in the neighborhoods and stuff, and the police was not showing up. And the day that I went to talk to the officers, first of all, no one called me when my son was killed. Mom's case
was entirely different. See, mine, they came to the house. In fact, my daughter was there, you know, because she had spent the night to look after Tommy's dog. And the police came to her house, I mean to my house there. And then he came back. When I was looking at this the other day, I saw where he had been. He was there several times. And I thought, and they never went to Diane's, yeah. Which is, you know,
and
it's not
the
right.
Come through and say the same thing.
Yeah. Okay. Funny. Yeah.
Yeah.
know you said it's not like really a closure, but do you think that if you had answers that you deemed that it would help you more to kind of like get through it on a, I know it's hard, but like on a daily basis, do you think if you had answers that it could kind of help ease your pain? Like for you, Ms. Diane, you said they never came or anything like that. So that goes to show they really, you know, gosh, if I was in your shoes, I would think they didn't care about me or my child because of my skin color too. But in her situation, they came to her. And so I feel like you may have a little more closure than what Ms. Diane has because they didn't do for her what they did for you. Does that make you angry that they did not come to you like they did to her, so that at least what you were holding on to or what you were feeling could at least have some type of, you know, like you can kind of sort of let it go because now, like, I know that such and such has happened, or, you know, like they came to you and say your son was killed by somebody. Now, if they hadn't came to you and told you that we got this person that killed your son and blah, 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 do you think that kind of would have eased your pain a little bit more?
In my heart, I hope I get that one day, but being in this group and being a part of it for all these years, we have families that come back after 30 years. We got families that have gone to court and they're still coming to our meetings 10, 12, 15 years later. And we deal with this question about closure. And they say, well, I don't know. It never ends.
It just, I mean, there's something every day that you think about your child. I never put Tommy's pictures away or anything, but there's something that will come along and you think, oh, so and so about Tommy. And I'm sure you do too, right?
Yeah.
It's little things that come up. That, and so there's no closure. Thinking, if Tommy were here, you know, he could do so and so for me.
And I tell people because, and the mothers seem to have this connection. And I write notes. Something good came out of this. My son saved 5 lives, and I found out that I'm a writer. but I write now, and I wrote this poem about the bomb that this child wore inside of me. And somewhere down the line, I did read something that some doctor had wrote about the connection of the child wore inside of the woman, that we grieve hard for some reason. We grieve hard and we grieve longer. And we have men come to the meetings, and they can attest to the same thing. They said they can kind of pull themselves together and try to move on and try to help keep things together with their life. And when a murder is a part of a marriage, a lot of people get divorced because they can never come back together the same way they were. Yes, sir. So did I answer your question? And I don't know.
Because I know it's not really an answer, but
I don't know. I mean, listen, I say that at the meeting sometimes when people say, you know, I go to court and I don't even know if I hurt them more than I hurt before I went to court. Even though I know who the person is in jail, and then the person usually gets for murder, the most they get to stay in jail is 4 years. 4 years.
4 years is what?
Not unless in North Carolina, it's got to be beyond whatever kind of circumstances. Most people out 8 years at the most.
Yeah, I had a cousin that was murdered, and the girl that killed him, she only did like 6 to 8 months.
Yeah.
Because that's what I don't understand. She didn't have a record, and so because she didn't have one, then it was like, oh, well, she killed another black guy. So what? Because he had a record, it was like, oh, he had a record anyway, so we're not going to worry about it.
And we say, well, we get victimized again and again. So we can't hear. Because it's something always reopening that room. Even when someone gets shot and killed, it opens that room. I think he was, I'm sorry, I hope I answered your question.
I'm actually glad you said something because I was my question. I want to start. not like, like specifically on mother responsibility, and you know, especially, you know, we all know the bond between the mother and especially her son, and you know, one of the best for family, but how did you respond to the family? Because I know you both say you got other children, you did with your son, that sibling. I know you say your husband passed before, you didn't know your husband or a spouse. So, but how did you respond to your children? How did you help them cope with that, help them cope with, you know, the passing of your son?
Well, I'm not sure how I helped my daughter. When you come right down to ask me that, I don't know.
Well, she's my sister now, and she helps with the organization. She and I talked about this, and she was saying, people don't realize what she was saying. She said people, when they were coming, over the years, as people check on things, they check on mom, but nobody asked me. That was my mother. And so they carry that, like my daughter. She don't want to be a part of this group. She don't want to talk about it. She had never gone back to the grave until last year. And the only reason she went back to the grave last year was she said her brother kept coming to her in a dream. And she guessed that he wanted her to come to his grave. So we don't take care of the siblings. And people just worry about the parents. So my thing is, it should be aftercare for the whole thing. It should be an aftercare system. Like I said, I donated my son's organs. And for a year after, they had an aftercare program. Because I donated his organs, every month they sent me a letter, a card. The lady that talked to me that night when I decided to donate his organs, she was like, I'm going to come by and see you. And I don't know if every person that helps me with organ procurement was that friendly, but for a whole year, that lady came to my house at least once a month or something to check on me. And they sent out cards and things. And she tried to, that's where I went and got the psychology help and stuff. They set that up for me. And just with plain old murder, there's no one to have programs in place to say, okay, this family's been injured by this murder. We need to see what this family needs. They don't do that. So that's why I feel we got continual repeating murders, because you're not going to this neighborhood or this family and putting something in place to help them with their pain, because it is a real pain.
I have a quick question. If you don't mind me asking, how far apart are the age differences in the
country? Mine are just 3 years. In fact, my son's birthday is today. Mm-hmm. He turns 59.
Mm-hmm. Mine is 6 years. I still say I have only two.
She's older than
you. Was my first daughter. And answering your question, my daughter, she said I forgot about her. She got angry with me. That was one of the reasons she moved out. She said it was like I just was consumed with her brother's death and her brother, and I forgot about her and her child.
I didn't forget about Charlotte because we were busy. Well, she got married the next year, so we were in the process of that. So, you know, a lot was going on. But when you ask that, though, I don't know that I did a whole lot except love her. You know, we used to hug, and I say that every day to open up her. She comes by that house. But at that time, I'm not sure what I did. I don't know what I did.
So, Ms. Hampton, has your son's killers ever tried to, like, write letters or apologize, and, like, you know, he
was a undercover police officer we had named to, and ever had to reach out to you at all?
The first part, what did you say of the first part?
Did they ever try to reach out to you, the murders of your son?
Yes.
Did you?
And he apologized at the trial.
Did you accept it or you couldn't?
Yeah, well, I just shook my head. I mean, what could I do? I accepted it. And I was, to a certain extent, I was afraid of him if he should get out. And I was glad he served time. And I said that he could stay there the rest of his life. But since then I've said that I hope that he learned a lesson. And his mother died, had a heart attack and died while he was sitting. And that really bothered me, that, you know, she grieved herself to death. I'm sure that's what happened. I'm not sure, but, you know, I feel that she probably did end up. And so, it's a situation, you know, you never know what's going to happen.
Have you ever thought about implementing any programs into your neighborhood to like help stop the violence?
I said I'm going to stand on top of the city hall buildings. Do you see me? Can you hear me? We were just talking about this on the way down here. Parents of their children is awesome. The Durham chapter, we have done a lot of things. We do things in the community. People try to steal our ideas. People come to me and ask me, that they hear about the stuff I do in meetings, and families go back and say and brag about stuff we do. And other organizations will come, which are funded by Duke Hospital, and they've got their little. And we don't get donations. We don't get donations. They get them. We were even used on a grant to get a donation, and someone informed us about it, and we contacted National. And sure enough, the person had wrote that we were not qualified to
be a part of
to do a training or have a support group that would get the money to help the families, which we have been doing it back then. This was 2012. We had already been doing it over 15 years, but you have come to our meetings for several years and you used our ideas to go back and write your plan. So, I don't know, we were talking about that on the way up, and I was saying, I'm tired. It's been almost 20 years and nobody recognizes that we are capable and donate money to our organization. We put in money ourselves. And we got families of work that, you know, and it's just sad. It's very sad.
We've made a murder wall. And we have, I have a picture here. This one is 2011, and we had that displayed at the courthouse. And every year there's a National Day of Remembrance, and it is was approved by the Congress of the United States, not just North Carolina, but it is set aside. The day is September the 25th, and we have tried to have something every year, and we have some newsletters here that show some of it a couple of times that we have done things like that.
And the little thing on the desk.
And we went to the opening of the
signing of the National Day proclamation. We went to that, I think it was
27. 2007 was
officially announced as a National Day. September 25th, every year, is a National Day of Remembrance for motor vehicles all across the nation.
And it's named for one of the girls that was, the parents of her, have to work with parents of her.
Lisa.
Well, I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
How does it make you feel as a mother of a murdered child when you see a mother murdering their child? You know what I'm saying? Like, how does, like, because I know that's me and I don't have kids, this is the opposite of somebody who is to a child. But as a mother who's lost a child and having to see a parent taking a child's life, what does that mean? Like, how does that make you feel?
And I hear my daughter talk about this because it happens a lot. And now what I say is the person has to be crazy or on drugs because no real mother is going to kill their child. There's something wrong with that person to kill their child. Now that's just my feelings. It's something wrong for that person to take their child's life. It's too much love there. It's too much. My mother's love is, it's something wrong with them. That's what I believe. Whenever I hear that, I said, there's something wrong with that person to kill their child. That mother, if she killed her child, there's something wrong with her. Mentally, or something, it's just something wrong. What about you? How do you
I agree with that. I just can't imagine getting so mad or angry or whatever it is that causes them to do this. You know, you get angry, but I can't believe that a person would get that angry unless they are mentally and
something
if they don't mind, then and maybe they really don't intend to do the damage that they do, but they are so uptight or something. I don't know that they do, you know, it's so that they lose it all together.
I don't know how it is.
Do you feel like losing an older adult child is different than losing a baby or a teenager because you don't have memories with your kids?
I think it would be to lose either one.
To lose either one. And the reason I say that, I had a sister, and she was living with me, and she had a baby to die from a crib death. And I almost lost the baby, and we only had little Carlos 3 months, and that just tore at my heart, and she still grieves, you know, and that was 3 months old. So I don't think it matters. I don't think age matters. It's still your child that grew inside of you. It's that bond. I'm taking up too much of your time.
No.
We usually break at 3:30. I was going to ask a question. In psychology, we often talk about having multiple selves. That means kind of like multiple identities. Like I have Megan, he is being a professor. I used to have one of being a student. I'm also a daughter, a wife. And you have the identity of mother. How has that changed since your son's been murdered? Or has it?
I don't think you never stop being a mother. Mm-hmm. Even though my son is gone, I still say, you just heard me say, I got 2 children.
That made me think of it.
I never stop being a mother. You never stop being a son.
Just like this weekend, well, Sunday, I'm putting flowers in the our church in memory of my husband and Tommy.
So I'm still a mom with 2 children.
One of the librarians here, her daughter died from a drug overdose, and she still keeps her bedroom exactly in the same way it was, even though it's been 10 years. I was curious, and I don't know why our society's like this, but and even the class back then, a year ago, was kind of a little bit judgmental of her that she still kept her the bedroom the same way. And I find that judgment part of it kind of interesting. I was wondering how your home has changed. You mentioned that you still have your pictures up and everything, and any maybe some judgments you felt about your own grieving process.
She still has a shirt, and I'm jealous. I was at her house yesterday. We were looking for something, and she was like, "That's Tommy's shirt. You still got Tommy's shirt?"
And
I'm divorced.
And I've got some tools and things, and just sort of things that you still kind of keep.
And I envy that because my son had moved out. He was 27. He was killed in the old hospital. He was staying. So, and then I got divorced, and what I did, I had one little musky cola case that he had left, and it still was musky years later. And when I got divorced, that was something I regret. I couldn't get his cola. I think that's an individual thing because we have people that come to the meeting and they say they had to get rid of all the pictures. They can't stand to look at the pictures. They don't want to think about it.
Right.
And like for Mona, like she still got stuff. I want stuff. I have one card that my son wrote me that I found some years later, and I have it on my dresser, and I'll rub my fingers across it every now and then because he says that you are my one and only true friend, and I kind of rub my fingers up just. And I do have his pictures. I talk to his picture every morning I wake up. I just say, "Good morning, I love you." And people might think I'm crazy, but I don't think I'm crazy.
I don't think I'm crazy. I just think that's a part of still, we know that they're there with us,
you know. And I have stories. You have to bring me back for the stories.
In thoughts.
Yeah.
and I mean, people tell different stories about different things that you go through. The little stuff that happens that makes you kind of think that there's something that gives you connection. So we got stories, and the Avengers have a meeting with people you've never seen in your life, and they say, "This happened to me," and we go, "Oh yeah, that happened to me too." So. I think she was me and her.
Could you tell us some of the stories about yourself?
Well, you're going to have to speak up, honey. I don't know. Well, she's
got home fire.
I admit I'm old. I can read it all.
I said, can you tell us some of the stories about yourself?
Yes, I can tell you one. A real quick, like, why did he skip school? I'm sure none of you did, but I was a teacher, and here I am teaching, and he comes home and says that he's got to stay home. Well, Tommy, what did you do? Well, he left school without permission and played around, and so he got caught, you know. So you missed a week of school. I was teaching kindergarten at that time, and guess what I had to do? Come and sit in my classroom. That's one. Can you imagine? And he was in high school at that time. Knew better. He knew better. Yes. You know what? If that wasn't a play place for him. But honestly. And then another time, he had a pickup truck. And see, he's 39 years old now. I mean, 59. He was 36 at the time he was killed. So back then, he
He was the friend to all the boys that wanted to move or go someplace. Always taking that pickup truck. Whether he was supposed to or not, but he did it. He wasn't an angel, but I thought he was.
One story that for me, and my son and my daughter are 6 years apart. So when my daughter was about 2.5, maybe 3, we had bunk beds, and he was on top and she was on the bottom. And she would always crawl up there and get in the bed with the brother. So this particular Saturday, he brings her in the living room. He said, She fell off the bed. She climbed up that ladder and she fell off the bed. So we took her to the hospital and had the thing on her arm. So I could tell that he had did it. He was just so nice to her. In and out. You want this? I knew he had done it. The funniest thing is, this girl did not tell me that her mother had no problem with the baby. But I can tell you now. Nicole was my daughter. So I had been wanting to dream about him because I hadn't dreamed about him after he died, and I was angry because he hadn't come to me in a dream. So he came to me in this dream, and the next morning I got up and I went in her room. I said, Nicole, I said, Butch came to me in a dream last night. And she said, Mama, I'm so happy that he did. She said, because I've been talking and telling him that he needs to come to you because you're going to cry yourself to death. And I have been crying for 2 years. And to hear her say that too, you know, like she said, I'm so glad. I said, oh, okay. I said, well, he told me you're pregnant. She said, I don't know why he told you that. Because I am not pregnant. 2 weeks later, she was at work. And she started bleeding. And they took her to the hospital. She had miscarriage. She was pregnant in her tubes and didn't know it. So right now today, if she has dreams about him and he kind of tells her something, she's like, my brother trying to tell me something.
What's her religion? Because a lot of people, I know we were talking about before, how a lot of people would say that you're crazy, dreaming about your sons or talking to me or something, or waking up and just kissing pictures, but I mean, this is one of those periods that we're in.
I'm supposed to be a Baptist, but I feel like I'm not in the
I tried to get her to come to that church and she won't come. She has been.
But we have a preacher, several people, two of them. Right now we have a couple. His son was just healed, and they are struggling. They are angry with God. They're blaming God. And we all try to share our stories because I never blamed God. Because I said, people forget that there's a devil. There's the devil. You know how people say, devil, man, the devil is real. I believe that. So and the way I explained to the pastor and his wife last month, because they were saying that they haven't gone back to church and he's finding it hard to preach because he's angry at God. And I explained to him, I said, well, what keeps me going is, to me, my God is a good God. Everything he does is good to protect us. And if I believe that God killed my child, what would my hope be? I got to have some hope in something. So my hope is that he has my son up in East Heaven Hill. People get mad.
I believe very much in the church and God. I really do. Of course, I guess you know that. I have been very active in everything with the church. And I have a dream, too, about Tommy. And I think most everybody in that group has said, we haven't had anybody talk about it lately.
He was talking about your belief in God.
Go back.
You got angry with God. Remember?
I did. So, I get angry and then I ask for forgiveness. I want to do the right things when time comes for me to go anyway. But I do. I get aggravated. But yet,
you have a question?
Am I doing the right thing? But I think I'm trying. I may not be to everybody, but
can you talk a little bit about what Parents of Murdered Children actually does, the support that they give to parents, and if our students wanted to get involved, the avenues they could take to get involved?
On your desk, we put one of the national pamphlets out, and on their website, they have a lot of different programs. And what Parents of Murdered Children does is families understand their grief and help them get through the judicial system. We kind of be there to instruct them on what's going to happen with the trial, what's going to happen with the police and this and that. Because a lot of people don't, this is their first time being thrown into something like this. They don't know the right questions to ask. They don't know that they're supposed to do this and this and this and this. So we kind of guide them through all the steps of what's going to happen since your loved one has been murdered. We are what you call a support group and a support system. We set them up with resources, like for extra counseling, and we find out where they can get counseling. We do court accompaniment. We've been, over the years since my incident, and I thank this lady and Nellie, we have the homicide investigators and the DA now attend our meetings. So the families get the one-on-one time to ask the questions that they don't feel comfortable asking with them by themselves. And when they do come to the meeting, they understand this is our safe place. So anything that anybody wants to ask you, they can ask you. And they got to understand this is our space, our time. And if you're angry, you want to get some of that. But in the end, we always say we can agree to disagree, but we're here to try to work together to mend what's going on in the families and in the community. And if we can't communicate with each other, we can't get to the root cause of the problem. And some of the problem is that the police is treating us like we were their enemy, when actually you need to help talk to us and help us so that we can understand what we're on, so maybe we can all work together and help each other. So now they're understanding that. And for the last 10 years, they've been at our meetings. Every meeting we have, homicide investigator and someone from the DA's office.
And it helps the people that come, you know, the parents.
And like I said, we're in need of anybody that knows how to look up grants, help write grants, or anything, or if you would like to participate, like we do National Day every September the 25th. At Christmas time, we do holiday remembrance dinner. What else do we do? And every year, there's a Victims' Rights Week. That is something that each and everybody can participate in. Every year in April is sponsored by the Juvenile Justice Department. Every city, every state has a Victims' Rights Week. And if you know about it, hear about it, go participate. Go stand with the families and stand with them and say that, you know, we're here to support you and seeking justice for the murder of your loved one. So that's something you can do. And you can always volunteer your time if you say, what can I do to help parents and their children? We'll figure out something. But go to the national website and look at that website. You see, they have like this thing called parole block, where they help families keep that person that murdered their loved one in jail the full amount of time. And they also have like this program called Ask the Experts. Like if a family hasn't got all the answers to their questions and they throw the case out, Parents of Murdered Children, the National has a group of experts that will look into that case for you and go back in and see if they can find you something that's missing. So go on the website to the National Organization and just see what they offer. But we locally, we offer the support group and we set people up with resources. You know, I'm the talker, so I go out and speak with people like yourself, go to schools, and wherever someone asks me to come speak, I'll go. And it's one of my main reasons is I want to save our youth, and there's too many of them down there.
Let's do, I just have one more thing I want to talk about. There's a sheet that you passed out, and we'll take a break about, and we haven't really talked too much about this yet in this class, about the things not to say when someone's grieving, and if you could talk about maybe things in a, that you felt inappropriate were maybe said to you, or why those things are on the list. If you could just quickly talk about it, and then we'll take a break.
Okay.
One
about God makes no mistakes. Okay, that one, that just pees people. Because while you assuming, like I said, that God did this, you know, people got different beliefs. Maybe to me, like I said, I believe that the devil, there's a big force in the devil's world, and that's what causes people to do evil and mean things. Mm-hmm. Now, that would bother me. Or he's in a better place, or she's yeah, in, yeah, her that's place funny. Was here with me. How do you know? Have you been to that place? How do you know the place is better? This is the thing that we've been meeting. Like, how do you know her place or his place gonna be here with me? How do you know that place is better? You been there? So that stuff like that bothers people. So what should you say? You shouldn't say anything. The most uncomfortable feeling I know for me, even with dealing with grief and I've been there, is a family coming in and they're just crying. And you don't know the right, and I've been through it, and sometimes I don't even know the right things to say. But most of the time, if you would just hold their hand or ask them, always ask a person, don't assume because someone is crying that they want you to touch them. Ask them, do you need a hug? Would you like for me to hug you? Don't just hug somebody when they're grieving, because some people are angry. So don't just go up and hug somebody. That's one thing to remember too. When you see someone is grieving, don't just assume that you can touch them. Ask them, is it okay if I hug you? Is it okay if I hold your hand? Make sure you ask them.
If we do that, see, they think that is so, everybody should. But we had a lady that came and she did not want to be touched or anything. We were touching, you know.
At that time, we had this thing in our meeting that we hugged at the end because everybody was okay with the lady. But this lady, we went to touch her and she was just, don't touch me. And that's when we went. So we started looking
we
it up.
We were very careful about doing that. Because we want them to feel comfortable.
But I learned the best thing that you can do is send a call. And always wait until about a couple of weeks after. Send a card. Because that 2 weeks after is like the hardest time for me. So wait at least 2 weeks and send a card or talk say things about you. And always remember to say the loved one's name. Because in our heart, everybody wants us to forget. That's what we're hearing. You need to move on. You need to stop talking about him so much or her so much. But we like hearing our child's name called. So when you mention that loved one, say, Sandra or Jack meant a lot to me also. Or I know that you're missing Jim. I miss him. You know, just always willing to say that loved one's name. It kind of warms that person off to say somebody else is thinking about.
I think so. That's a good way to end. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, guys, so take your 5 to 10 minute break. When you come back, let's get in the circle.
No, that was.
Thank you. Thank you.